I'm Scott Galland. I fell in love with the web around 20 years ago, and I've been working, building things for it for most of my professional career. Oops, am I? Yeah, three years ago at this very conference, I announced a budding open source project called TinaCMS. And during that talk, I described how the future of content editing was going to look a lot less like WordPress and a lot more like Squarespace or Wix, or in this case, Weebly. That this type of editing experience was going to go from site builders and come to a developer-first CMS. See, developers love content management systems because they're often open source, they're extensible, we don't feel limited by them or boxed in, you know, to a proprietary product. But content creator love site builders because of the ease of use and the slick UX. And since announcing TinaCMS 3 years ago, we've been super focused on building something that's best in class for both DX and UX. And I'm excited to share that today we're coming out of beta and releasing the 1.0 version of TinaCMS. Tina's innovating in two key ways. In one, we're writing content to your files in a repository, like Markdown, JSON, or MDX. And two, Tina brings visual editing to a developer-first open source CMS. So let me tell you about these. Writing content to Markdown is really powerful. You own your content in a Git repository. It's not locked behind a third-party service. You avoid database headaches, like multiple environments and syncing data. Instead, we just work with branches and pull requests. And then you get other benefits of version control, like diffs, histories, and rollbacks. But it's hard to do something like this and say, you know, give me all my blog posts with the movies category. And you often end up with something like this. One page has a title, and the next page has a title and a date. You don't get that structure to your data. And typically, Markdown-powered sites are static only. And static only means you can't have server-side rendering with dynamic content or client-side fetching. Or you can't do incremental builds where, you know, you fix a typo on your site, and it kicks off a build process for your entire site. But what if you could use your Markdown data not just in the compilation of a static site, but also as you would a headless CMS, giving you the best of both worlds, like version-controlled content in open formats, but with a responsive API so you can query your data? Well, with Tina 1.0, we provide a data layer that indexes the content of your repo and handles requests much like a headless CMS. And since the source of truth is in the content repository, it's almost like an ephemeral data layer. And you don't really need to manage it or worry about it. It's kind of like a cache. And having that data layer is really powerful. Now we can do filtering and searching and paginating and sorting across your Markdown files in your repo. And that example I just showed you of, you know, getting the blog post with the movies category becomes trivial. You can create references between your content and your repository. We can power dynamic sites and static sites. We can get consistent data across a repository because Tina is driven by a schema where you model your data. And now we can use Markdown at scale for sites with thousands of pages. So to show you this, here's an example of Smashing Magazine site using their Hugo site using Tina CMS. They've got, I think it's about 10,000 blog posts, and they just load in a few seconds here after it hits our API. And then clicking into one of the pages, you'll see that the structured data is all there. But this is just Markdown data, like YAML, Markdown. And it's consistent across their entire site. On the UX side, Tina brings visual editing to the CMS. Tina 1.0 is agnostic to frameworks. And any framework can get the experience I just showed you, which is just that regular basic editing experience. But if you're using a modern JavaScript framework like Next.js or Remix, you can get a more visual editing experience like this, where Tina loads a preview of your site in an iframe. And now your content editors can get, you know, instant feedback as they're editing content. And we're seeing really interesting projects spin up in the community. Like, this is a project called MicroGen. It's an open source site builder built by the team at Protocol Labs. And now their team is able to crank out sites in hours instead of days or weeks. And they're creating a variety of sites, all with a unique look and feel, all powered by their one open source Squarespace, essentially, MicroGen. OK, so I'm going to show you a demo of Tina. And I'll show you how you can customize it for your project. I've got a simple site here. It's a Next.js site with one heading. And if we look at the config file for Tina here, you can see that we, in the schema object, we define the shape of your data. And there's one collection called page. And then we have one field called title. It's just a string. And that field is represented in the Markdown file here. And then it gets rendered to the page in this h1 tag. And we fetch the data from Tina and pass it through the useTina hook here. And what that looks like in the CMS is just what I kind of showed you in Smashing Magazine, but just a lot more simplified. So I'll update the content here. And you can see when I go back to the Markdown file, it's updated. And that will be committed to your GitHub repo if you're using this in the cloud and not working locally. But pretend this. We've got a really picky marketing team. And they're like, well, we want more than that. We want more pop. So we have this confetti launcher component. And we're going to drop it in right underneath that H1 tag. So great. Clicking that, sprinkle some confetti on our page. So we want to give our marketing team a little bit more control over this, though. We want them to be able to edit like what that button text says. And how much confetti comes out of that confetti launcher. So we're going to go to that page and just add some properties to that component. It knows about this stuff, so it has some defaults. But we were going to override those defaults here. And then we go back to the config file, to our schema. We're going to paste in a we're going to extend those fields by adding the button text and a number field for the confetti volume. So that should show up here in the CMS again. There we go. We'll put in 500 or something here. So this is where Tina really shines, is like, you know, for a content creator, they don't know if 500 is the right amount. They don't know if 5 is the right number or 10,000. So we want to give them a custom experience that's going to be like tailored to their use case and make it a little bit more easy for them. So I'm going to show you what it looks like to build a custom component and drop that into your schema here. I'm just going to paste it in here, but it's just going to be a slider field. You can see it's type an input field type range. There's some properties get passed into this. And we can change the max number to 20,000. We import React because it's a React component into the config file. And when I refresh, you should see the slider. So there you go. We just customized Tina and dropped in our own component. And it's writing to Markdown. So we can put Tina 1.0 is now live. Test out the slider. Works good. But you know, our marketing team, they're a little bit over the top. They think this is a pretty big event. So they're going to max it out. And there you go. So we're seeing teams that have struggled with other headless CMSs adopt Tina and become super efficient right out of the gates. And with Tina 1.0, we're combining visual editing with Markdown-powered content to create the best UX and DX. Thanks very much.